please welcome Steve Blake.
So I'm not sure how the presentation could get better than that, so that might be the high point of your evening. Hopefully not. In fact, what we're going to do is save you the time from having to read the entire book. And we'll give you the snapshot right now. And you know, this talk is about this process called business model design and customer development. But in reality, I kind of think it's about how to fail less. And so what I want to do is, how many of you want to start a company? Anybody? Okay. Yeah. And they're all sitting up front. You could always tell the entrepreneurs get the best seats, right? Everybody else, the rest of you hide in the back. But the people want to start something. They're up here because it's, you know, the density of the knowledge is somehow deeper up front. And someone else goes, yeah, seat up here. The problem is, though, as smart as you are, most startups fail. Even in Silicon Valley, it doesn't work like it in the movies. 90% of the deals that the best venture capitalists fund in Silicon Valley fail. 90%. Wow. It's kind of like worse than going to Las Vegas. The good news is the 10% that do make it make them such incredible returns, they're still in business. But I want to remind you, after 50 years of doing this, they still can't figure out exactly which ones. And so what I want to do tonight is just share some observations on how to increase the odds and how to fail less by just thinking through what it is we want to do. So I'm going to tell you what we used to believe on how to start companies and what we now know. And then I'm going to talk about some of those details, what are called business models and customer development. And then I'm going to give you some details on customer development, and if we have time, we'll go through some examples. What time? How much time do we have? As much as I want. Well, never say that to me.
I know
you can dinner. We'll be bringing in breakfast. So what we used to believe for strategy is that all you need to do is write a business plan. Anyone ever hear about a business plan or write it? Right? Every venture capitalist said, oh, you put in your market and your opportunity and you write it, and somehow you sprinkle holy water over it and magic will happen, right? A magic bean will grow or something. I mean, you know, if you just execute this plan, just like the venture capitalists tell you, magic will happen. And we now know as a fact that that's not true. This is a big idea. Writing a business plan is not a path to success for a startup. And I'll tell you why in a second. But the other thing about it is, anybody ever have to do the back of the plan, the income statement, balance sheet, and cash flow? You know, that's your five-year forecast. From those of you from Russia and Poland, does anybody remember that your parents telling you about the five-year plan? Right? There it is, right? And it had the same relationship to reality as the five-year plan. Right? So some of you kind of remember that. Now, I have to tell you, for me, going to Russia for the first time last year was amazing to understand that no one under 30 remembers communism, and everybody over 30 is trying to forget communism. It was just actually quite wonderful. But in any case, this is like the five-year plan. I still believe this should be taught, but I now believe it should be taught in the English department because it's the best example of creative writing any entrepreneur will ever do, because it also has no relationship at first. Be careful. I'm not saying you never need to do this. I'm just saying writing a business plan and writing a spreadsheet first is a mistake. And so the question is, what we now know is, so what are we supposed to do first? And I'm suggesting what we need to do first is do some planning before we write the plan. It's a big idea. Why don't we just think through what is supposed to go in that plan, other than every VC wants to see a business plan and a balance sheet and a campaign. What is it that we're supposed to be planning? And I'll suggest two things. One is, we want to start thinking about our business model. And I'll be explaining this in some detail later, but a business model are all the pieces that make up our company. Any engineers in the room? Right? So every engineer, at least like I used to believe, is, Steve, Business model, business model, who cares? What's really important is my idea. It's all about the technology. It's all about, you know, and like if I get stuck on my idea, you know what I do? I add some more features. And if the customers still don't like it, I'll add even more features. Some of you aren't laughing, okay? Because that's exactly like, that's what you do. What we're going to find out is your idea is just one of many pieces of your startup. And the difference between success and failure is you understanding the relationship between your idea, your customers, your sales channel, how you create demand, how do you make money, etc. And that understanding all these pieces before you add more code, before you build more hardware, before you spend more money or hire more people is really the secret sauce. And we're going to spend some time thinking about it, but instead of a business plan, we're going to be talking about business models. And the guy who came up with this is a guy named Alexander Osterwalder. And if you have another book on your shelf, we won't like burden you with two carrying it around, but you should buy this one when you get home. It's called Business Model Generation. And unlike this, which is 600 pages of text, which will make your eyes melt, his is all pictures. And it's great. It's all pictures that kind of look like this. It says, I get it. My startup really needs to worry about the pieces of the business before we start writing documents like business plans. So what we now know is the hypothesis about your business go before you start writing business plans and spreadsheets. And by the way, I use the word hypothesis because I teach at Stanford and those students pay $50,000 a year and they want to tell their parents they've learned big words. So what's another name for hypothesis? Guess. Yes. So really, if you think about it, a startup is nothing more than nine guesses. You're guessing what features, who your customers are, what sales channel, how do I price it, what's my pricing strategy. A startup is nothing more than an implicit set of guesses. This is a huge idea. Because for those of you who woke up passionate and visionary and I'm going to change the world, on day one, you are leading a faith-based enterprise. It's faith. It's your vision. That's all you got. And your vision to attract other people. But very quickly, you need to turn this faith-based enterprise into facts as soon as you can. And that's going to be the next part of what we do. Because what we used to believe was after you wrote a business plan, what you wanted to do is hire product management people and do what was called waterfall engineering. Product management people manage all the features and, you know, tell engineering what the specs are. And our product introduction model and so used to look like this. We used to have an idea. We'd raise a little amount of money. Product development would start engineering the product. We'd go into alpha test, beta test, and first customer ship, and we'd ship the product. Does anybody recognize this? We don't do that anymore. We don't do it anymore. Just about the time you kind of got this figured out, we're telling you it's wrong. We're telling you it's wrong. And by the way, this is how we used to engineer products. We'd spec the entire product. We'd go into design, implementation, verification, and maintenance. And this was called waterfall engineering. Seemed very logical. I know what I want to build, and I could design it and implement it, verify it, and then maintain it. It turns out that's wrong. And the reason why that's wrong is it assumes on day one, you know what problem you're solving for the customer. This is a huge insight. We used to believe because you had a vision, because you were a founder, I must know what problem the customer wants solved. Why? Because I woke up with a vision. Maybe I used to work in that industry. Or maybe my friends told me it was a problem. But in reality, the minute you believe you understand the customer problem, you implicitly say, well, therefore I know exactly what features to build on day one. We now know that's a mistake. There is no possible way sitting in your dorm or your office or a building inside that building, you could have complete knowledge of what it is customers want. It's impossible. As smart as you are, that's an NP-complete problem, meaning computationally impossible. But this is how we used to do it for 50 years. Why, of course, we'll just kind of spec it. Don't bother us. We're now busy implementing version 1.0. And when it's done, we'll ship it. And the only problem we're going to have is figuring out where to put the bags of money, right? I mean, we're just going to need enough office space so we could store the cash. Doesn't work that way. And we kept doing this, though, somehow hoping if we did it enough, it would work that way. And it never did. What we now know is that most startups fail from a lack of customers, not from a failure of technology. Even in Silicon Valley, where we take more technical risk per square foot, companies, by and large, don't go out of business because they can never deliver the product. Don't get me wrong, they're never on time delivering the product either. But they go out of business because they lack enough customers. Well, that's interesting. If they lack enough customers, what's the process for getting the customer part right? And so what we've come up with is this customer development process, which is the heart of the book in your hand. It basically says, look, what we really want to do is establish a set of hypotheses, guesses, about who our customer is, what our features are, what our revenue model should be, and then we want to go outside and test them. And the most likely outcome is we're going to be wrong. We're going to be wrong about something. Be wrong about the features, about who the customer segments are, about how to price it. And unlike in the old days, we're not going to fire you. You're not going to be fired. You get to keep your job a little longer because we're going to say failure is a normal part of a startup. That's a huge idea. That is, instead of executing, remember that spreadsheet, the five-year plan, and assuming the five-year plan was given from on high, and therefore it cannot be mistaken? We're going to assume that your initial ideas are more than likely wrong. It's a huge concept. We're assuming that your initial ideas in a startup are more than likely wrong. And therefore, what we want to do is iterate and incrementally design the product and learn as fast as we can. A startup actually goes from failure to failure, learning inexpensively and rapidly. Does that make sense? It actually corresponds to how the most successful startups actually built their companies. But now what you have in front of you is a method that finally writes that down. And so this process, customer and agile development, goes before product management. Only after you have a stable and shipping product do you go hire product managers to go do that. The last piece is what we used to believe is organization. We used to believe large companies have heads of sales and heads of marketing and heads of business development, and startups, well, startups, you want to have a functional organization as well, right? It makes lots of sense. Big companies have it, and Facebook has it, and Apple has an org chart, and in fact, I can't wait till I have something that looks like this, right? Turns out, this is also wrong. Turns out, on day one, there is no sales or marketing or business development organization because you have no idea what it is you're selling or marketing. It's really easy to hire people with those titles. But if they have no idea what customers want, they're going to just be doing random drunken walks and saying, well, maybe this, maybe that, maybe this. It turns out it's your job as the founder to lead a team to understand what customers want. Now, let me give you a, let me talk about this. Founders run something called the customer development team. No sales and marketing and biz dev until the founders figure out who the customers are. So if we start with a customer development team, and then eventually we do set up sales and marketing and biz dev. Let me explain why. Who's the CEO of a startup? Am I a CEO? Are you a CEO? Great. Hire a VP of sales. Pick her. Hire her. All right. VP of sales. Get out of the building and ask some people whether they like your product. Go ask him. It sucks. Tell her. All right, go talk to someone else. Go ask somebody. It's horrible. It's terrible. All right. Go back and tell your boss. Now, what do you say? What's the first reaction?
I've seen the presentation before.
Yeah, tell her. Great. So tell her.
Let me go on.
No. What do you really say?
You're fine.
No. You're not explaining it correctly. That's the first thing you say. Now you go out again, blah, blah, blah. You get the same reaction. Go back and tell them again. You explained it differently. Say, tell them it's still. Now what do you tell her?
Now you're fired.
Don't laugh, right? The average half-life of a VP of sales of a startup in Silicon Valley is 9 months. 9 months, okay? Now I'm going to change the game. We're going to do it my way. You're still the CEO. I don't let you hire anybody. You're not allowed to hire a VP of sales. You get out and talk to the first customers. Go ask him what he thinks. All right. What? No. And so what's your first reaction when they say it's a terrible idea? What's your first reaction, honestly? They're idiots. I'm the genius. It was my idea, right? It's a natural human reaction. It's your idea. It can't be wrong. Now you ask someone else, and about the third person you ask, because there's nobody in between you and the facts, smoke starts coming out of your ears. Cognitive dissonance is, you had this vision. Yet the facts that are undeniable, you can't blame it on a VP of sales. You have to deal with them. And number one, you have to deal with them. And more importantly, because you're the founder, guess what you could do? What can you do? You could change anything. You could change the features. You could change the customer segment. You could change the pricing model. But what you can't do is hide from the facts. If you want the most effective way to do this customer development process, which is culturally very hard, is that you push away the traditional functional organization on day one and say, we're putting together a customer development team run by the founders to very quickly iterate through this business model. So that's what this part means. So the strategy, process, and organization are all described in the Startup Owner's Manual. And again, the idea isn't that we're never going to have a plan. The idea isn't that we're never going to have product managers. And to be clear, it's not like we're never going to hire sales, marketing, and biz dev. It's that we do those second. It's a big idea. It's not that I'm saying we never do those traditional things. I'm just saying we've been missing a whole part of the process because in a large company, in one that already exists, you do this. But for the first year or so, a startup needs to invent and do this, which is different from what you learned in every large organization and what they teach you in business school. In business school, they teach you this. No one was teaching this. Make sense? So part two, let me just give you a little more detail. Even in Silicon Valley, you asked 15 people, what's a startup? And you got things like, oh, it's the place I get to bring my dog, or, you know, we get free food, or, you know, or we get to code, or, you know, with some great people, and it's exciting. But no one ever gave anybody a definition. I'm going to give you Steve's definition, which is actionable. Meaning, if you think this through, you now would, like, understand what it is you're supposed to do. One is, a startup is a temporary organization. Whoa, it's a big idea right there. The notion of a startup is not to become a startup. In fact, the goal of a startup is to become a large company. It's not to have a great time with 8 people, you know, for the next 4 years. In fact, there's no such thing as a 10-year-old startup. There's a 2-year-old startup attached to an 8-year-old failure, right? A startup is a temporary organization designed to search. This is a big idea. Because I thought a startup is designed to code or build hardware or do something. No, it's not. It's actually designed to search for something. What's it designed to search for? For something that's repeatable. As if I do it on Monday, I could do the same thing on Tuesday, and it will scale. And I'm looking for a repeatable and scalable business model. That's my definition of what a startup is. And if you deconstruct this, it actually tells you what you're supposed to be doing if you're running one. oh, it's temporary, so my game is not to be a small company forever. And my game is not just to write code or to build a product. It's to search for a business model that can scale. A startup aims to become a company. And so if the goal is to search for a business model, so what's a business model? It's how a company creates value for itself while delivering products to customers. And as I said, it has 9 boxes. And let me just remind you, the 9 boxes, number 1, value proposition. Value proposition is a fancy word for what's the product or service you're building. What is it? And more importantly, who are you building it for? Is it teenagers, predominantly male, 14 to 18, who play video games? Is it women 45 to 55 in urban areas? Is it CIOs in large companies who manage, you know, big data sets? Who are these customer segments? How do you deliver it? Is it directly through your website? Is it through a direct sales force? Is it through an indirect channel? How are you going to get, keep, and grow customers? What kind of relationships are you going to have with them? How are you going to acquire them, activate them, convert them to purchasing? What's your revenue model? What's the strategy and what are the tactics for pricing? Kind of on the back end, what resources and activities do you need? Do you need any partners? And what are the costs? The sum of these is your business model. Your job as a founder is to figure out all these pieces. And on day one, some of the most important are what's called product market fit. Does your product match a segment of a set of customers who raise their hand and say, this solves a problem or satisfies a need that I really have? And as I said, you realize that they're just hypotheses. And you could really start mapping them out with just putting little yellow sticky notes on a business model canvas. But the way you actually test them is realize they're just guesses, and you want to turn these into facts. And how do you turn these guesses into facts? You get out of the building, and you use this customer development process I mentioned earlier. You're searching for a business model. The first thing you're going to do is test the problem, and then test the solution. And the odds are, as you get out, you're going to make changes to your business model canvas. Your hypotheses will be iterating and will be changing. What you're going to be doing is starting with a set of hypotheses. In this case, we think our customers will be male, 24 to 35, in urban areas. They like Starbucks. You're going to be designing a set of experiments. Why don't we run a set of Google AdWords to actually see if we could acquire those people. We'll run a test. Hey, look at that. And oops, we keep getting teen girls in suburbia. Well, you know what? That's some interesting data. We've just run a very cheap and inexpensive experiment. Instead of spending hundreds of thousands of dollars, we just spent $50. And when we take a look at our data and we say, that didn't quite match, what do we need to do? We either need to change one of our hypotheses, maybe a small change, that's called an iteration, or maybe we need to make a major change called a pivot, which we'll explain in a second. The other thing about customer development is because we are not going to build the entire product on day one. We're going to build something called the minimum viable product. The MVP, or minimum viable product, says instead of trying to guess every possible feature these customers could want on day one, we're going to build the product a piece at a time, the smallest piece we can, and run these tests. We're going to ask them as we get out of the building, and their customers are going to give us feedback. Yes, you're on the right path. No, you're not, etc. So the MVP is a key part of this customer development process. But the heart of it is something called the pivot. It's when we run one of these tests and we finally convince ourselves that some of our initial hypotheses are just simply wrong. The pivot is defined as a major substantive change to one or more of those business model canvas components. It says, we really got the customers wrong. They're not teen boys. They're middle-aged women. Or we got the pricing model right. Wrong. It's not freemium. We should be having a subscription model. Or, gee, our channel shouldn't be the web. It should be a direct sales force. Those are major substantive changes. Why this is such a critical idea is how we used to solve pivots before is we'd fire you. Yeah, we'd actually look for you and we'd fire you. You personally, actually. Pivots now save executives' jobs at startups. It's a huge idea. Now the first thing we fire is the plan, not the people. We used to fire people to change the plan. Now we're just assuming that the plan will be wrong, and it's okay for a while. Eventually we'll fire you. In fact, we'll find you again. But the idea is we're going to fire the plan first. And so a pivot is when hypotheses don't match reality. So customer development is how you search for the model. The first step in some detail is called customer discovery. You're going to state your hypotheses, test the problem, test the solution, and pivot. You run two different parallel streams. If you're in a web mobile application, you do one thing. If you're in a physical channel, you'll do something else. And here's some details from the book. Step one is you state your hypotheses, you test the problem, you test your solution, and then you either pivot or proceed. The next step is you actually try to physically sell the product, incomplete as it is. You get ready to sell, you sell to early customers, and you develop some positioning, and then again, you decide whether you have a business that's worth scaling or not. So do we have time to talk about how does it really work? Okay. Let me give you an example. This was all theory. So I used to be an entrepreneur. For 21 years in Silicon Valley, I did 8 startups. 2 semiconductor companies, some supercomputer companies, an enterprise software company, video game company. I was lucky that 4 of them went public. One of them I actually retired on. But for the last 10 years, I've been teaching. I teach at Stanford, I teach at Berkeley and Columbia, and now Caltech and Princeton as well. And this example came out of a class at Stanford. We teach this, it's called the Lean Launchpad class. All the slides I have are on my website called steveblank.com, all my student slides as well. And these were a bunch of computer scientists who took the class who said, we want to build a robot lawnmower. Now, you're supposed to laugh because this is what their parents sent them to Stanford to go do. They wanted to build a lawnmower that's like a robot. And they said, we can't think of a more exciting thing to do for this class than build a lawnmower that, you know, something that would mow the grass that was a robot that didn't need people. And we said, you've got to be kidding. They said, no, you don't understand. We're machine vision experts. We could use GPS and we'll put a laser in it and it'll mow the grass. And we went, all right, okay. And so they called us, these are all their slides, an autonomous large-scale mowing, and maybe we'll do some weeding for farms. And they said, it'll look like the Mars rover when we're done. And we went, okay, all right. And so the first thing they did is the whole class is about not just how smart you are in the class, it's all about this customer development process. So the first day, they had to get out and talk to potential customers. So they did 20 interviews. And they interviewed the Stanford golf course people and parks in the Silicon Valley and asked people would they like a robot, and it was great. And we also pointed out to them that near Silicon Valley, believe it or not, about 80 miles from here, is a huge agricultural area for the state of California, Salinas Valley. We said, well, why don't you talk to some farms? And they said, Professor Blank, everybody will love the mower, you know. Why do we need to talk to them? Go talk to some farmers. And so they interviewed a bunch of farms in the Salinas Valley. And their first business model canvas said, look, we're going to reduce operating costs because we're going to make a lawnmower and we're going to sell our machine. And, you know, it's all about mowing. And, oh, yeah, they made us put up weeding, but it's really about this robot lawnmower. But they actually talked to some of the weeding guys in farms and they found out, hey, being able to pull out weeds in the United States for organic farms, it's a huge problem. Well, they understood the mowing problem. They didn't understand that it requires crews of hundreds to thousands of illegal workers who are smuggled over the Mexican border, truly, who are picking weeds one at a time so we could eat organic food in the United States, right here in California. And this was actually costing these farmers $250 to $3,500 per acre. These are all their slides. They found this out in the first week. And so now they had a decision to make. Wait a minute, do we want to be in the mowing business of large fields, or do we want to make our robot do weeds? And of course, I said, why don't you ask them the question? They said, what question? I said, well, how much is your robot going to cost? Well, $250,000. I said, and how much does it cost to hire that guy to ride the riding lawnmower today? Oh, we didn't ask that. $8.50 an hour. And I said, are they going to go buy your machine? And the answer was obviously not. So they had a decision to make, and they decided that maybe our business, this is now week two, is actually in a robot for weeding, not mowing. So they updated their business model canvas. They changed their value proposition. They changed their customer segment. You can see major pivots here. But they still thought they were selling the machine to agricultural dealers and service providers. Oh, now one of the things you've got to understand is if you take my class, you're not only getting out of the building, you've got to build the product. Now, this is easy if you're doing an iPhone app. But when I told that to these students, they thought I was joking. They said, Professor Blank, you can't build a robot in a quarter. You know, what are you joking? We might get it done next year. And I said, let me show you something you've probably never seen at your career at Stanford. And I went up to the whiteboard and drew the letter B. B, beta, B. Anybody ever see a B? No one at Stanford had ever seen a B. And these students went, a bee? We can't get a bee. We've never had a bee in our career. I said, bee. So you should look at it and make sure your parents will understand that this is what you're going to begin. We're going to complain to the dean. We can't do this. There's no way. You could build something in a week. Blah, blah, blah. They showed up next week with a carrot bot. I knew they would because they were smart and good. They spent 100 hours, no sleep. I didn't want to know what drugs were involved. But they built a machine vision platform for data collection, had monochrome and color cameras, laser line sweepers, encoders, machine vision software. They were about to mount on it an ex-DARPA military high-power laser before I told them not to do that because they're going to kill a farm worker. So this was good enough for me. And so now this is week three. Week three, they now have, a robot, and their business plan canvas is now. Now they're focused on cost reduction, they're focused on organic farmers, and now they're saying, wait a minute, maybe we ought to rent the equipment rather than sell it because the farmers are teaching them how their business works. And so they're now saying, look, we got pictures of weeds and carrots. By the way, this is the carrot, this is the weed. They have lots of pictures. I said, it just looks like dirt to me. Oh, no, you don't understand. Here's what's important. And so they're now really getting into their customers. They could tell you all about farm equipment. More importantly, they're drawing models of how their customers work, about how they're, like, here's how they make decisions and here's what's important. And there's no way, sitting at Stanford, these students ever would have been able to draw for you how farmers in the Salinas Valley in California work. And now they're taking pictures with Cliff, the farm manager, and their new friends, and here they are with Marty and Doug, the grower, and they're really kind of excited. They update their canvas again. Now they're understanding something really important. The farmers are now telling them that maybe you should price not just the equipment, not just a rental, but maybe you should price it per day. And maybe it should be based on the density of the weeds. Whoa, there is no way you would ever figure out how to do pricing based on weed density sitting in your office at Stanford. So now they say, listen, we really need to get the technology and the intellectual property nailed down. It turns out at the same time, the World Agricultural Exposition, a trade show, happens to be in California. They have to go buy denim shirts and cowboy boots, and they actually sneak into the show and they pretend they're farmers. And, they're giving demos of their equipment to other farmers around the world at the show, and they finally update their canvas. And they now come out with a final pricing model. And this is an example of what students did in 8 weeks. They thought it was so exciting when they graduated, they started this company, and they're out now building this for real. So I want to leave you with that as a good example of how this translates from theory into practice, and thank you very much. I'm here to take questions if we have some time. So one of the things the students are constantly surprised about, and maybe it's the United States, maybe, but my bet is it will happen everywhere else in the world. If you're doing something interesting, and the first thing you say to somebody is, listen, I've heard you were the smartest person in this industry, and I don't want to sell you something. Because they don't right now. The whole point of this process, which is really hard for an entrepreneur, is saying, and meaning, I don't want to sell you something. I'm trying to understand your problem, and then later on, I'm trying to understand if the thing I'm building actually matches what I think is your problem. People will talk to you. Not everybody. But the hit rate is close to 50%. Truly, if you start with, I need 20 minutes of your time, I got your name because you were told to me was the smartest person in this industry, and not trying. Imagine somebody called you like that. You'd have to be really mean and dumb. You'd feel dumb for hanging up. You don't want to sell anything, and you're trying to. And yes, one of the models that says, "Well, listen, it's iOS apps and Android apps, and you know, I don't ever have Zynga doesn't meet there." You know, it turns out that's just a mistake. You could get a ton of data electronically. But if you're not correlating the data you're getting in the beginning with seeing some percentage of that data, watching what I call their pupils dilate when you ask them questions, you have meaningless data. What I mean by that is, anybody ever take a survey online? Yeah, anybody ever lie? Oh, come on, it should be 100%, right? Come on. You know, sometimes you give them real answers and sometimes you make it up. So when you're starting your company, to be depending 100% on just random feedback, I believe is a going out of business strategy. I believe you need to cross-correlate that data with physically figuring out how to get some percentage, not a high percentage, but enough, so you could ask them the same question again, eyeball to eyeball, and watch their reaction, and actually watch how they use the game or use the website and develop heat maps with eye tracking, et cetera. Very easy to do and not very expensive. But it starts with the, I love online data, but you got to understand that people lie. Once you correlate that percentage like wrong, then you could constantly, you know, use that data. But unless you have what I call ground truth, now eventually, once you have that, like what I call correction factor, you know, you could take longer and longer breaks before you go back and do that. And I found that out just painfully, like believing in the data. And then when you asked them for money, everybody said yes in the survey, and then no one said yes on the product. You know, what happened? What happened is you believed your own BS, right? You were happy to get the data, but you didn't correlate it. That's all. It's the same with market research data. I don't know, overseas, anybody ever use market research data? You know, these. So anybody work at a market research company? Because I'm about to tell you bad news. So market research firms are awesome at predicting the past. Because if they were great at predicting the future, they'd be a hedge fund, not a market research fund. And I don't mean, you know, they're dumb or stupid or lying. It's just that trying to understand inventing the future, that's not their business. They could take the best guess, but it's actually you guys who are going to be inventing the future, not the market research firm. So why I love their data, and it is valuable, it's in fact to try to understand the current state. But to actually use it as a forecast, well, you know, any fool could do a straight line. That's not what the business is. You're going to be changing what the line looks like. The nice part is, you know, the pivot now has given permission to people for a couple of things, and not all of them good. You know, a pivot says, why don't you just give up and come up with another idea? And so in some businesses, it might just be you haven't spent enough time or energy or talked to enough people, etc. And this is why entrepreneurship is not done by accountants. Entrepreneurship is still an art. And the art is knowing, gee, if I'm in enterprise software and 30 people who are CIOs told me it was a horrible idea, it's probably a really horrible idea. But if I got 30 pieces of data for an online game, that's not even the beginning of getting enough information. So it depends on the industry and the segment and the data and the validity and what questions you were asking. So number one is I want to be careful is the word pivot has given us permission to constantly, you know, flip-flop. You've got to be careful before you change. It's a major decision. The other implicit question is how long does an entrepreneur stick with a startup that's not making money? That's really, again, a personal decision. I'm going to tell you a funny story. My personal answer was about 3.5 years. When it didn't make it, I just had about a 3.5 year window, and I believed life is too short. It wasn't a year, but it was about 3.5 years. I worked with somebody at a chip company called MIPS Computers, a guy named John Masouris, who left to do another company. I'm trying to called MicroUnity. After that, another microprocessor company. It failed. It failed miserably. Everybody abandoned John. You know, he ran out of money after raising like, I don't know, close to $100 million. And John didn't give up. I mean, when everybody else thought he was the biggest fool in Silicon Valley. He was down to him and his wife and his secretary and maybe two people for 12 and a half years. I mean, that was it. But John had patented a lot of stuff. And then one day, for some reason, I was reading the Intel annual report where it said they just settled a patent lawsuit with MicroUnity for $560 million. After 12 and a half years, John owned the entire company. So I could give you personal examples of I would have ran away from that company 4 times. So it really is, you know, maybe John knew something I didn't, like maybe he has another life and believed in reincarnation. I kind of believed for an entrepreneur, life is kind of too short. But the question is, how short is short? So there's a classic thing in the U.S. is Steve Jobs never listened to customers and Henry Ford never. It turns out that that's probably the worst advice. And it was done by stupid Apple PR people who didn't have any clue what they were saying. It turns out, by the way, when Steve Jobs was alive, he lived about a half a mile from the Apple Palo Alto Mac store. And so did I. And so about once a month, I'd kind of walk by, and there was, you know, a crowd in there trying to act cool and ignore the fact that Steve Jobs was in the store. Oh, yeah, we're cool. We don't see Steve. Now, you know, it took me about 2 years to even have the light bulb go off. Gee, does Steve Jobs, is he not able to get a computer delivered to his house? What the heck is he doing in that Apple store? Why is he spending the time watching customers? First question. Second question, when Jobs was alive, he used to send an email to some customer at least once a month, right? People would email Steve, how come you're not doing X or Y? And most of his things, or can you do, you know, how come my favorite feature would be no or F you? I mean, that would be Steve's email. Now, no one ever asked, is that the only email this guy was reading that entire month? Or was he actually reading and getting, like, intensely involved with some customer feedback? It turns out that there are 4 types of startups. And I'm going to just do them quickly because it's covered in the book. One is startups in an existing market. How do we know we're in an existing market? Anybody? How do we know? What's the characteristics of an existing market? Competition. What else? Customers, right? Somebody else. What else? Right? Product. Right? So think about it. In an existing market, you got competitors, you got users, and the users could tell you what are the key features. In an existing market, your job is to go out and exactly ask those people, hey, what do you want better? Because you're going to go in and kick the butt of those incumbents. It could be that the market, though, is driven by incumbents so large, think of Facebook or Google or Apple, that a head-on attack is suicidal. So what you might want to do is take a segment of a market, understand deeply user needs or prices or costs, and develop a product that's either a lower cost or addresses specifically user needs. I call that resegmenting an existing market. Still, you need to understand those features, et cetera. There's a 3rd type of market for those of you from overseas, and that's called a clone market. You take a look at what's going on in the U.S. You go, hey, dumb Americans, they don't get our culture or our country or our language. It'll take them 4 years to figure it out here. We're doing, you know, Facebook or Google in name of country here. And if your name of country happens to have 100 million people or more and regulatory or cultural barriers, Russia, China, Brazil, India, etc., you could do a nice job reinventing U.S. business models. Again, because you don't have to invent them, but you do have to understand your cultural needs. And the 3rd one, though, or the 4th one, is something that's really hard. And this gets back down to the Jobs and Steve Jobs and Henry Ford thing. And that's inventing a new market. That's where you see something no one else does. There aren't any customers. There isn't any channel. There isn't anything. The good news is, if you're right and you live so long, you might be rich. The bad news is you're probably hallucinating, right? And so getting out of the building and asking customers what feature they want is insane. But not understanding how people solve their problem today and what you might be substituting for or what the world looks like is also equally insane, being locked up in your garage. So because people don't have more than 24/7 in a day, if they're not going to be doing what they're doing now and using your stuff, why is that and what's the transition? So if you're attacking a new market, also getting out of the building is important, but important for a different reason. So they're taking a full course load when they're doing this. I've been told how many credits I give, it's not enough. I teach this in universities as a standard quarter semester class. I've now done 5-day versions for Columbia in New York. We're going to offer the 5-day version twice a year. We're going to offer 5-day version for Caltech. I also teach it for the National Science Foundation in the United States. This process will now be the front end for all scientists and engineers who want to get what's called an SBIR Phase 2 or 3 grant. That is, in the U.S., the National Science Foundation is the government organization that funds all science and engineering in universities, except for health and medical stuff. We give out probably $7 billion a year in grants, and probably about 10,000 grants a year. And out of that, about every year, about 500 of those grantees raise their hand and say, we no longer just want to be researchers, we want to figure out how to commercialize this technology. And it's for those people that the National Science Foundation has just adopted this process and this class. And we're now teaching, this year we'll teach 150 teams, next year we'll teach 300, then eventually we'll put it online and teach thousands in the United States how to use this process to go from, gee, I have a great idea, to all the pieces necessary. And it's been real fun because I thought I knew this class would work for 20-year-olds with hoodies and flip-flops, but it was interesting to see if I could get 45-year-old average age of a principal investigator who hasn't been yelled at since he was 22, in front of the class. And it actually works just fine. How does it work in the U.S. for National Science Foundation? They have to apply to the NSF for this class that's online. It's called the Innovation Corps. They get interviewed by National Science Foundation program managers. Eventually, when they get into the final interviews, the teaching team. And it's really about the team as well as their technology. And so it's everything from everything the National Science Foundation funds, computer science, materials research, medical devices, et cetera. It's kind of a lot of fun. And not only do I teach it now, we're training other universities to teach it. University of Michigan, Georgia Tech will teach it next in July. By the end of next year, we'll have 15 major universities teaching for the NSF this program. And other countries are kind of interested in figuring out how to do this in their country. Because it turns out it's a very stupidly simple process. If you just think about what I've been talking about, there's no real invention here. It's kind of like one of these, oh yeah, we probably, instead of writing it up, should be going out and figuring out whether our hypotheses are real. And that's what this process is kind of formalized. It's not much invention, but it's a very handy methodology. So it's very funny. Eric Ries, one of my students, came up with something called the Lean Startup methodology. Anybody ever seen Eric's stuff? Yeah, you should all have a copy of his book. He was the best student I ever had. In fact, whoever asked the question about eyeballs on web startups, it was when I funded Eric's company called IMVU, is that we learned all about trying to do this without seeing customers even on the web. So in Silicon Valley, this has gone from a nice theory to kind of almost de rigueur, meaning you have to at least talk the talk literally in the last 3 years. And the reason why is the adoption of some process was necessary for web and mobile apps because, the traditional rules just all broke down for venture capital. An entrepreneur could start on their laptop with a set of credit cards or maybe friends and family or $100,000 by using Amazon Web Services. That's now a computing utility like electricity. So all of a sudden the whole model's kind of changed, but they had no framework of how to think about what were they supposed to do. And most of them have adopted, at least if you're doing web and mobile apps, some version of this, or at least lip service. And I find the transition just humorous, where when I was talking about this 5-10 years ago, it was, I was hoping someday somebody would figure it out. And literally, Eric's work, Alexander Osterwalder's work, my work, and others are now what I call an emerging stack for entrepreneurial management. It's not just this idea. It's, in fact, there's now a stack of knowledge that's starting to become available to entrepreneurs that says something very important. And what it says is all the stuff you learned in business school is great for execution, but is not great for search. And we're now inventing new theory for this front end. And you should be so lucky to need the execution stuff. So there are some VCs. So for example, when I was teaching in New York, there's a guy named Fred Wilson who runs a firm called Union Square Ventures, probably the best VC or well-known VC firm in New York for software. And so Fred, somebody asked him this comment, and Fred says, listen, by the time you come seeing me, you're hopefully done with your pivots, which I thought was a very interesting observation. We value it, glad you're doing it, but I'm not funding you to do pivots. On the other hand, in Silicon Valley, there's a super angel called Dave McClure, who runs something called 500 Startups. Dave is happy to have you doing all the pivots because he's not giving you a ton of money. He's happy to have you, be pivoting. So it really depends on you asking the venture capitalist, where in the process do you want to have me? They all now understand the language. But it's still kind of a fair question to say, so how mature do you want me in the process? I was pretty naive in the beginning. So unlike my smart students who are 20-some-odd-year-old, all want to be CEOs, I was actually worked in the apprentice model. You know, I stumbled into my first startup. And by the way, on my website, steveblank.com, you could read all the stories of every possible way to screw up a company, because I'll tell you about them. And so my career was, you know, a training instructor, a product manager, a marketeer, a VP of marketing, eventually a CEO. It was only about, and by the way, for the first 4 or 5 startups, I have to tell you, driving this main highway 101 in Silicon Valley, I remember multiple days being afraid that my boss was going to figure out how much I loved working there and make me pay to work at the company. That's why I worked in Silicon Valley. For at least the first 10 or 15 years, I just couldn't believe you could work in such a place where they allowed, you know, somebody with no skill, no training, no whatever, you know, to like experiment and work on some of the neatest technology in the world. So the first couple of startups, I was just doing it because I loved it. Eventually, I discovered money and stock options and then became a little more rapacious. And so at the end, it was about engineering exits. And I got lucky in the, well, let me tell you, the next to last company, which is also a truly Silicon Valley story. The next to last company was something called Rocket Science. It was a video game company. I made the cover of Wired magazine. In the US, that was a big deal in the 1990s. Cover of Wired magazine. I promptly cratered the company and lost $35 million. Called up my mother, had to tell her that. And in Russian, she said, are they going to make you pay the money back? And then I said, no, no, Mom, you don't understand. The reason I'm calling you, I'm no longer depressed, because the same VCs just gave me $12 million to do my next company. And then she said, in Yiddish, you know, only in America are the streets paved with gold. That's why we came to this country. And it really brought up a much different issue was, do you know what we call a failed entrepreneur in Silicon Valley? Anybody know the name? Experienced. That's not only a joke, it's the culture here, which is what makes this place unique, is that if you have failed honestly here, I mean, you didn't steal the money or you didn't, you know, treat your employees badly, etc., the next time you have coffee with a friend after you've lost $35 million, their first question to me is, so what are you doing in your next company? Not like, did you have to change your name or were your parents embarrassed or, you know, and remember, bankruptcy laws in the U.S., literally allow you to shut it down within 3 weeks. It was done. You know, no years of worrying about whatever. It was done. Now, why that's an interesting story and why I tell you about failure is out of that failure, I decided to go back to stuff I knew about, which was, you know, selling to marketeers and large major corporations in the U.S. So we did another startup, happened to be in the last internet bubble. But by the time the company went public, it was worth $8 billion. I returned $1 billion each to the two venture capitalists who invested in that last company. It's the only in Silicon Valley story. So my eighth startup was one of redemption after the next to last one was one of the most abject failures you could have think about. And the failure taught me a lot. It was all about hubris and ego and about, you know, too much BS rather than delivering. And the next one was just like, we are going to execute this thing and deliver real value to customers. I don't care about bubble or not. And the bubble added multiple zeros to its valuation. But at the end, it had real customers and real revenue. The whole customer development process will develop more rigor, more domain-specific knowledge. You know, I've kind of took me a while to figure out the difference between, oh my gosh, there's a different path between web and mobile. I already see if you were doing medical devices, I'd be having another path. If you're doing life sciences, there'd be something else. That is, the process at its highest level is the same. The details would be different. I'm not a domain expert in each one of them. And hopefully other people are going to add value on top of all this. Osterwalder and I, the guy who wrote the business model generation book, our next step is to write a joint book together, which we're going to try to do this summer to get it out this fall or next year, where we integrate the process tighter than what we do. But hopefully I could get the conversation going, and hopefully Eric Ries has a whole series of stuff going on. As I say, it's not, you know, in the old days when I was not retired, I'd be selling you something and telling you this is the model. And now I don't really care. I am going to say this is a model. And the one claim I will make is this A model is a lot better than what we used to be doing, but there will be smarter people to be piling on top of it, I hope. And I gave you some areas, and if I knew all of it, I would try to do it. What I'm trying to do is just get it as broadly adopted as I can in educational institutions, which is really hard because, boy, if you've been teaching the same thing for 15 years and now someone comes in and says, you know that stuff you've been teaching? You've been wrong. It's not an easy adoption path, but it's actually happening. The question really is okay, you develop something repeatable, but, you know, is this sustainable? Is this? Now, that's different from, you know, like, what do your VCs want you to do versus do you want to build a long-term company? And they might not be the same. And that's a really question. So if you, again, I'll pick on Fred Wilson in New York, who's looking to build startups who could have networks of users measured in millions or tens of millions. And Fred's implicit assumption is if you pushed them hard enough, you know what, we'll figure it out later. Give me 10 million users or 100 million users and we'll figure out the business model. And the business model might be this is how we'll make money, or we'll sell the darn thing to somebody who needs 10 million or 100 million users. That's not quite sustainable for you building a 20-year company, but it's certainly sustainable enough for your investor who's looking for an obscene return. And so really the question is, you know, which question are you asking? So if you were asking me, in a perfect world, without VCs looking for immediate exits, what would I do? Which is different from what are VCs telling their startups to do. Right? VCs are happy for you, the entrepreneur, to always swing for the fences. Right? They're happy for you to take maximum risk. Why? And this took me a while. While you just see one VC, they have 15 to 20 companies they're going to board meetings for. And so they're managing a portfolio. How big is your portfolio? One, right? So while they're happy to take risks across a portfolio, your risk profile is kind of different. Does that make sense? And so you got to constantly ask yourself, and it's a phrase I use, are our interests aligned with our VCs? And during the search process, of course they are. They're betting on you to find a repeatable model. But now for scale, gee, are they happy for you to build nothing without any revenue, be dependent on whether you could raise, you know, $100 million, time the market, et cetera, get sold? Or do you want to start charging for this stuff and you're happy with a million users who are paying? But gee, that makes you less of an acquisition candidate, but it just keeps you in business for the next, well, gee, now your interest has become unaligned. Does that make, but gee, if your interest was how can I make the most immediate amount of money now by selling my company, then your interests are aligned again. If you say, I want to build a company to last 20 years, that's not why your investors invested. They invested to make a return within the lifetime of their fund, which is 5 to 10 years. It's one of these examples of, even in Silicon Valley, we still work with asymmetric information, right? Meaning the VCs have more information than you do. They're not sharing their exit strategy with you because you'd be asking, well, where are you in your fund? When do you need an exit? Why, you know, what's your, oh, we want you to do the right thing. Yeah, well, until you get a first offer. It's very funny, right after this, I'm having dinner with Jeff Immelt, who's the CEO of General Electric, who's exactly trying to do this in large corporations. So here's the funny thing. I'm going to tell you two, and if I forget what your question is, it's because it's a great question. I'm going to go off tangent for a while. Number one is, when we talk about startups and innovation, we kind of forget here in Silicon Valley that what we call startups are not what the rest of the world called startups. Let me just remind you that a startup in Silicon Valley historically used to mean a scalable startup. I want to be Google or Facebook or Apple. I want to build a billion-dollar business. So I'm going to need to raise millions or tens of millions of dollars. It's what the Valley grew up on. Still kind of true. But there's now another category in Silicon Valley, which I call a buyable startup. I'm 22 years old. I want to do an iOS or Android app. I'm happy if I get bought out for a couple $1 million. Thank you very much. And I got a new class of investors who are happy to give me 100 grand because they can make, you know, 500 grand. Thank you very much. Both of those are Silicon Valley models. But outside in the United States, startups and entrepreneurship actually refer to small businesses on what we call Main Street. People starting grocery stores, or one-person consulting firms, or doing database marketing, or selling insurance. They are self-employed. They might, you know, hire some friends or neighbors or family. But their growth is kind of limited, and therefore the amount of capital they could raise and where they could raise that capital is limited. Those are small business entrepreneurs. Turns out in the United States, 50% of all non-governmental employees are small business entrepreneurs. Yet we don't teach that kind of entrepreneurship here. We kind of like look down on them. The other type is your type, corporate entrepreneurship. It turns out in the last 20 years, the life cycle of corporations have become shorter and shorter, meaning you start as a startup, you grow large, and then you decline rapidly, sometimes for things out of your control. Technology changes, consumer taste change, regulatory changes, new countries, China Inc. shows up, manufacturing costs change. Unless you're capable of innovating and dealing with outside disruption, you are going to go out of business. And if you don't think this is real, go ask Nokia and RIM. No, these were some of the smartest companies in the world. They were making better and faster and cheaper phones every year. They were doing sustaining innovation better than anybody else. But even after Apple came out with the iPhone and they put one on the boardroom table, these guys could not process that this was the device that was going to put them out of business. They laughed about it. And so large corporations dealing with disruption has been a business school, professor, you know, set of theories for the last 50 years. And here's my theory back. Business school professors were the wrong people to solve this problem. Why? Because we hadn't solved the two-body problem first. Two-body problem is, tell me how you make two people in a room successful before we try to solve the 100,000 people dealing with disruption. I just think in the last couple of years, we have finally figured out the two-body problem. My work, Osterwalder's work, etc. I think we can now take that and now try to apply it to large corporations dealing with disruption. So I just think we've been looking in the wrong place for those solutions. I also think that, you know, once you take the what did you learn about building startups, you now also have to deal with all the political and cultural things about execution, right? You have HR, you have P&L, you have bonuses, all focused on doing the same thing repeatably and scalably. And actually, the people who could save you are the ones you tend to fire because they're mavericks. And not only is the pivot difficult, setting up a new division to do disruption is difficult, which is why large corporations typically deal with disruption one of four ways. You try to build it yourself, which is really hard politically, not technically. You try to partner, or you try to buy it. And you buy companies that have already kind of grown past that and have some P&L and revenue, and you could say they figured out the problem. And so this is not like an easy problem for large corporations, even though they understand it. And so me and Osterwalder and a couple of other people are now going around trying to tell large corporations that there are some other places to be thinking about where these solutions come from. Now, this is a problem with disruption, is that large companies tend to protect old business models until they go out of business. Ask Kodak stockholders how they felt about Instagram being worth a billion times more than their company. No, seriously, right? Think about it. Kodak, been around for 100 and some odd years or 150 years, three guys or two guys, you know, did some photo app, it was worth $1 billion. Kodak was worth negative money, right? I mean, it's kind of interesting. It's this whole creative destruction thing. The problem is that existing employees tend to be focused on existing models. Right, and this is what you want them to do most of the time. Just focus on your business. Here's your bonus if you do more of the same. But what really fails are large company boards of directors. It's not the employees. It's the board and the CEO. Boards and the CEO always need to be looking at the external factors that are threatening their company. And those are the people. And right now in the U.S., we have the compensation completely screwed up. You know, it's all focused around quarterly returns rather than, wait a minute, where are you positioning the company for the next 5 years? And the marketplace seems to be taking care of this kind of efficiently because they tend to go out of business faster, but, you know, these guys tend to leave with a ton of money before they crater. You know, I think we're going to see more of this and more of it kind of happening in a faster and faster period of time. And I think this same startup culture that we're talking about, this whole customer development methodology and the whole lean methodology, is eventually going to be embraced by large corporations who will also start getting into this rhythm. Because this isn't an intelligence test, right? There's nothing I've talked about which is particularly brilliant. It's just about a process that you need to actually, you know, constantly do. And so in large corporations, hopefully you'll have, you know, boardrooms talking about each division is competing on a multiple business model. You'll have them start thinking about what are the threats, where's the disruptions coming from, and worried all the time. I sat on a couple of public boards for a while, and this is really hard, especially when your numbers are looking good. You know, hey, what do we need to worry? And I'm sure that's what Nokia and Rim were saying 5 years ago. This is a joke. Because here's the trick, or the bad news, is in a large corporation, disruption always appears as a toy or a joke. It never appears as a $50 billion competitor. It appears as, what do you mean they're going to build it in China? Ha ha ha. You know, or what do you mean people will want to do apps on their phone? Ha ha ha. You know, it always looks silly. It's in fact understanding the potential threats and what to do about them early on. I think in the U.S. we're at the verge of figuring out how to do a whole new generation of startups, though, making Main Street kind of employable in a way that they weren't employable with this new shift, because we're going to have to figure that out. And that's hopefully what I'm going to be helping with as well in this country. Now, customer development is not collecting the massive feature list. It's real easy to say, oh, I get it. It's one giant focus group. Just collect all the feature requests and go do that. No, it's not, because that's also a going out of business strategy. Remember, you're starting with your vision, right? And what you're doing outside the building is step one, is the first thing that would make me incredibly happy is that customers say, your vision is completely right. Don't add a darn thing. That's what you're looking for. It's only if and only if they say, no, 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 but only if you had this feature, but I want to hear that consistently, not like one feature from this customer and one feature from this customer, or else you're a custom house and you'll never be done developing the product. Does that make sense? That's why this is an art. It's why accountants don't run startups, or else you'd be having a spreadsheet collecting every possible feature. It's why it's an art. It's why an art. So what you're trying to make sure is you're not optimizing the local maximum, you're looking for the global maximum. And if you knew what the global maximum was, you wouldn't have to leave the building. I'm trying to tell you it's not an engineering problem. It truly is. Here, how many of you computer science? Anybody know what MP complete is? Right? Here, you could explain it to the people next to you. You're trying to turn an MP complete problem into an NP hard problem. Right? Right? Only the computer science people are laughing, right? That is, you're trying to turn something from that's completely incalculable to something that is just darn hard, and you need to, and that's what I'm trying to offer, is a set of bounding boxes around the problem. There's not an infinite set of choices. We could very quickly collapse the problem into a finite but large number of choices that still require some skill. And that's the best I could tell you about this. Well, you know, I taught the class in New York. We had them get out of the building at 3 o'clock, and they had to come back talking to people by the next morning. 13 teams talked to 1,200 customers in 5 days. 1,200 customers in 5 days. And literally, I know that I'm pushing them hard when one group, at least out of 10, gets arrested during the class. Or at least escorted out. And it happened. They got, you know, they were so aggressive trying to get into a hospital to see doctors. They got like, you know, and I got a phone call. They're claiming they're students in your class. And so when I'm talking about, you know, customer development, I'm talking about in your face, in places people don't want you because you're running out of time. And this is a simulation of what happens in the real world. I don't want you to get arrested. But in the real world, unlike a large company, in a large company, you're doing this with a safety net. What's the safety net you have in a large company? What's the safety net? What can't happen in a large company? You won't go out of business. And you won't run out of money. In a startup, the gun to your head is you're running out of cash. You know, unless something happens or your mother's funding you, you're out of business. And so there is an air of desperation. And if there isn't an air of desperation, you're not doing it right. And so that's what I try to, so a good number of these, and I don't know if that's what you had in mind, but I put them in some situations. And you know, I remind them when I used to do this in Silicon Valley, I would call people up in New York and get them on the phone. They say, oh, yeah, too bad you're not in the city. I'd love to chat with you. I'm going to be there on Tuesday. Oh, too bad, because I'm going to be there. I'm going to be there on Thursday, too. Okay. I'd get on a plane for a 15-minute meeting. And I set up some other meetings, but that's what it was like. And I try to teach that it's relentless. It is a relentless process if you're a founder. So when your dad's asleep, go into his wallet. Right. Oh, you already did that. Okay. So the good news is pre-high school, pre-college, is that you ought to practice as much as you can starting companies, knowing that in your family, not only is there no penalty, is you will be looked at every time you do one as a hero by your dad. Right? Is that true? Right? So I would do this with no fear. No fear. You can't fail here. Even though it might not work, you ought to understand you cannot fail. And by the time you get to college, you are going to be more experienced than any one of your peers, and they're all going to follow you. So that's my advice. Right. So it's the last question. Who has the best question? No. Who has the best question? You sure? Best. Don't put your hand down.
No one asks
best. Okay, best question.
You wrote the book with your co-author.
Yes.
Bob.
Yes.
So he appears like experienced entrepreneur too.
Yes.
So what was his contribution, and why did you choose to write the book with him?
That's a great, no one has ever asked that question. So the story about Bob is actually great. Now, my co-author is Bob Dorf, who happens to be a great personal friend. And the story how we met is actually a great entrepreneur story. And I like the way Bob tells it. When I started my last company, Epiphany, I had kind of figured most of this out. And I didn't know we were in an internet bubble, but I knew how to do it. To me, I was going to engineer this startup. And me and my co-founders at Epiphany, we kind of knew this was going to be right. So we got our first building. And while it had desks for four of us, it had space for 120 people. You got to understand, there were four desks, and there was a giant room. And when Bob came to visit, because he was in a startup that had six people, he was 50% larger than us, but he didn't have space for 120 people, he had space for 15. And Bob came in and visited our company and looked at me and looked at all the empty space and said, this guy's either crazy or understands that he has a vision that's going to get pretty big pretty fast. And Bob and I became good friends from that day, and our companies worked together. He ran and grew a company called One-to-One Marketing. There were guys named Don Peppers and Martha Rogers who did something called One-to-One, which in the 1990s was a big trend for marketeers. And Bob grew that to 400 people in his company. And so we kind of worked together, and our families liked each other, and our wives liked each other, and so we kind of kept in touch for 10 years. And Bob tended to be the marketing expert. So the parts of the book that's the Get, Keep, and Grow funnel, that's all Bob's work. And so Bob added immense value on that. In the last 10 years, he's been doing a lot of web startups, and his expertise was just in that area. And so I was kind of thinking about how do I take the four steps to the next level, and Bob just added tremendous value as well. So what you're really getting is the sum of both of our expertise. And you know, Bob's is even as older as I am, so you have something like 50 man years of expertise in this book. So thank you very much. Thank you for the time, and I'm glad to be here. Thank you.